Good evening. Welcome to this historic event that's being live streamed from this site in Turtle Creek, East Pittsburgh, where the first KDKA broadcast took place 100 years ago. We're back now in the replica of the shack with some very special guests. My name is Ken Gormley, and I'm the president of Duquesne University. We're honored to host this event along with the National Museum of Broadcasting here in Pittsburgh, Westinghouse Shore, and RIDC, all of which have worked for years to preserve this important story in both regional and American history and to share it with the world on this special night. We spent years literally planning to have live events and displays to mark this occasion, but the COVID pandemic knocked those plans off track. But that was not going to deter us. We were all determined to celebrate this historic occasion. So that's why we've gathered on this spot tonight in this exact replica of the shack where KDKA made its transformational broadcast. And tomorrow night, I'll host a second evening of events down here with some distinguished guests, including Larry Richard from KDKA, a filmed appearance from Jack Bogut, iconic KDKA announcer, the actor David Conrad, who is the great-grandson of inventor Frank Conrad, Jim Robinault, who's an expert on the Harding-Cox election of 1920, and some political commentators who will discuss parallels between the Harding-Cox election of 1920 and the election of 2020. We'll then discuss and comment on returns of the Trump-Biden election as we receive regular updates from the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette desk, just as broadcasters in 1920 did as they received updates from the Pittsburgh Post, the precursor to the Post-Gazette. It will be a fabulous night, and we hope you can join us for that as well. But tonight, we'll focus on the history of the world-famous KDKA broadcast that took place exactly 100 years ago tonight, as well as the impact of the revolution to radio broadcasting that originated in this spot, thanks to the ingenuity of Frank Conrad and Westinghouse, and we'll see a reenactment of that first broadcast from 1920. So a packed night of events. First, it's my pleasure to welcome Ron Klink, a well-known figure here in this region who served as a popular reporter for KDKA television for many years before serving four consecutive terms in the United States Congress and then becoming senior policy advisor for Nelson Mullins in Washington, D.C. Ron serves on the board of the National Museum of Broadcasting, and he has been an integral part of the planning of these events over the past few years. We appreciate your partnership, Ron, and I know we have a few proclamations from dignitaries and also another dignitary here, so let me hand it over to and welcome the Honorable Ron Klink.
Well, first of all, Ken Gormley, thank you very much. I can't move forward without recognizing what a wonderful job you and the people from Duquesne University did on the documentary. The lead-in, I mean, I've been working on this project for decades, been working in radio since the 1960s, and I learned a lot just based on the documentary that you all put together. I think it's fabulous, and thank you for capturing that for the people. For those of you out there who remember a dark-haired, clean-shaven, thin Ron Klink that used to read the news, I'm his grandfather. Not really. But I'm happy to be back with you, even though as radio has changed over the years and begat television and now the internet, we are live streaming on YouTube, so things keep changing. There were a lot of dignitaries that were supposed to be here, but as Ken Gormley said a little earlier, there's another election. It's not the Harding-Cox election, but it's the Trump-Biden election, and it just so happens that Joe Biden is here in Pittsburgh. Many of our local politicians are with him because he's with Lady Gaga, and she's going to perform a couple of songs. And John Legend, I am told, is performing from Philadelphia, and so they're going to feed the music. They would rather be with Lady Gaga listening to her and John Legend than be with Ken Gormley and Ron Klink here in East Pittsburgh. But that's their loss nonetheless. It was kind of interesting, though, as Ken laid out my background. I was at KDKA television for 14 years. I did a lot of work at KDKA radio. We were co-owned by Westinghouse when I was there during those years. 1978 to 1992. And later on, I continued to do work sporadically for KDKA radio. I like to do talk radio on occasion. And then when I went to Congress, I got on the committee, which actually has the oversight of the broadcast industry. Now imagine what it was like when my former bosses had to come and lobby me because they wanted something from me now. So I know Pittsburghers will understand that. When I left United States Congress to run for higher office, I went to run for the United States Senate, my dear friend and fellow Congressman Mike Doyle took over the seat that I had on the Energy and Commerce, and now he is the chairman of the committee, which has jurisdiction over broadcasting. So Pittsburgh Power comes back home again, and I understand, Ken, that you've got greetings from Congressman Doyle, who is sad that he cannot be with us this evening.
Yeah, well, I think he wanted to see Lady Gaga, too.
He did.
Ron, I grew up with Mike Doyle in Swissvale. Mike has been a great supporter of all things Pittsburgh history, and so we really appreciate his sending this statement that I'd like to read. I appreciate the opportunity to mark the 100th anniversary of the first commercial radio broadcast. I'm sorry I couldn't join you live, but I appreciate the opportunity for my statement to be read. 100 years ago today, Frank Conrad, with the support of Westinghouse, made the first ever commercial broadcast over KDKA's airwaves here in the East Pittsburgh works of Westinghouse. Westinghouse, which manufactured radios, was hoping that offering radio programming would increase the market for its products. It did. In fact, it was such a success that 600 commercial broadcast stations popped up nationwide over the next 4 years. 2 years after that, in 1926, the Radio Corporation of America established the first national broadcasting network called, not surprisingly, the National Broadcasting Company, or as we know it today, NBC. Since then, radio has been a medium that brings people together. It's had a remarkable transformative effect on our lives, from pop culture to the economy and national politics that can still be felt today. And it's another reminder of the important role Pittsburgh has played in our nation's social and economic history. It's fitting that 100 years later, we are on a precipice of another presidential election, and KDKA will again play a big role in reporting the results in our key home state. I'm happy to join you in celebrating the legacy of Frank Conrad, Westinghouse, and KDKA Radio. Thank you for inviting me, from the Honorable Mike Doyle, member of the United States Congress. We're so honored that Mike was able to participate in this fashion, Ron.
Thank you very much, President Gormley. And we have a couple of other people who were going to be here, wanted to be here, and could not, but they've sent their regards as well. Greetings, it is my pleasure to join KDKA in celebrating the 100th anniversary of the first radio broadcast, November 2nd of 1920. Since the invention of radio, millions of listeners have joined together in a culture of music and storytelling that has united our nation at times of turmoil and of peace. Over the last century, KDKA has diligently provided the Commonwealth with news and entertainment. KDKA and its audience continue to influence change and strengthen our economic and social framework. The station's evolution in the ever-changing media landscape, and with communications and dialogue at the forefront, ensures that it's a powerful voice that will continue for many years to come. As governor and on behalf of the citizens of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, I'm delighted to honor KDKA and celebrate this milestone. Please accept my best wishes for continued success. Tom Wolf, Governor. We thank you, Governor, and we know you wanted to be here as well. One other person who was supposed to be here, and again, because of, I think it's Lady Gaga that, Ken, that rained on our parade tonight. But at any rate, this is a proclamation, KDKA's 100th anniversary day, Monday, November 2nd, 2020, whereas KDKA went on the air in Pittsburgh, the Pittsburgh area, as the world's first commercially licensed radio station on November 2nd of 1920, and whereas while amateur ham radio operators and military communications had been sending messages over the airwaves for several years previously, Westinghouse Electric's KDKA was the first official station starting a radio boom across the nation and the world. And whereas Assistant Chief Engineer Frank Conrad had already been making broadcasts via ham radio in the immediate Pittsburgh area, but there was little demand for radio receivers outside that relatively small group of aficionados. And whereas Westinghouse wanted to create a demand by having regularly scheduled broadcast programs across a variety of subjects, having seen Conrad's local success broadcasting music, talking, and giving sports scores, and whereas a small shack was built on the roof of a Westinghouse building in East Pittsburgh, complete with antenna and a 100-watt transmitter. On October 27, 1920, the Department of Commerce issued the first commercial radio station license under the call sign KDKA. And whereas KDKA's creation of a new industry did not take long to start, profoundly affecting the nation, and whereas for a century, KDKA has continued to pioneer the medium of radio. Its role has not only changed Pittsburgh forever, it changed our nation and the world. Now, therefore, be it resolved that I, William Peduto, Mayor of the City of Pittsburgh, do salute KDKA on the occasion of their 100th anniversary. I commend the hardworking staff and broadcasters who have worked to enhance and preserve the national treasure that Pittsburgh calls home. Furthermore, declaring Monday, November 2nd, 2020, as KDKA 100th Anniversary Day here in our most livable city, Pittsburgh. Under the great seal of the City of Pittsburgh, William Peduto, Mayor. So, Ken, you were a mayor. You can appreciate the thought that went into that.
I was indeed, and I can tell you Bill Peduto has been just a fabulous mayor who really does have a great knowledge of history and a deep appreciation for history. And so he has done a lot to keep alive the history of this city and this region. And so it's wonderful that he could be part of it tonight in that fashion.
And as my understanding, a lot of people thought that it was really East Pittsburgh, but I understand that the first broadcast actually came across the line into Turtle Creek, Pennsylvania.
That's correct.
And I understand that we have the mayor of Turtle Creek with us here.
Yes,
so let us invite Mayor Kelly Kelly of Turtle Creek. Come on in and join us, and I will let you talk to where are we going. Do we know where we're going to put her?
Where would Mayor Kelly
sit? We have her here.
Mayor Kelly should sit where, Don?
Do we have a microphone for her?
Oh, God, yes. Sorry.
Okay, I apologize.
Mayor Kelly, let me just begin by welcoming you. We're so pleased to have you here tonight. As Ron was saying, we know that many times people say that this historic event took place in East Pittsburgh. I think we know that specifically it was here in Turtle Creek, which was part of the East Pittsburgh Westinghouse plant at the time. So you can both share the glory, but let me say, as the former mayor of Forest Hills, and I was privileged to be mayor when the CBS and Westinghouse donated that historic site on the hill that Frank Conrad worked from to the borough of Forest Hills that is still preserved today. But we appreciate the great work that you're doing here in Turtle Creek and in the whole valley here that represents the area where Westinghouse thrived. And so we are so thrilled to have you here this evening.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm very happy to be here, and thank you for the invite. I just prepared a little, just a couple of words about the historical significance for this
evening.
Please
share them with us.
Okay. Again, thank you for inviting me to make a few remarks this evening at this wonderful event. The Turtle Creek Valley has been the epicenter for several noteworthy events throughout history, and it's always an honor to be a part of this celebration. From our beginnings as the native lands of the Turtle Clan of the Iroquois Nation, to early settlers like Martha Myers, who hosted the likes of George Washington, the Turtle Creek Valley was at the forefront of developing industry. George Westinghouse recognized the benefits of the valley with its proximity to coal, the city of Pittsburgh, and railroads, and moved his electrical manufacturing business here to the area in 1891. Tonight we celebrate the 100th anniversary of our nation's first commercial radio station broadcast that happened right here in the Turtle Creek Valley. Westinghouse became the first company to apply for a commercial radio license, and Frank Conrad, who was the assistant chief engineer at Westinghouse and had already built himself a following by broadcasting news and music from his garage in Wilkinsburg, built a shed atop the Westinghouse K building in Turtle Creek, where the first commercial broadcast would be aired. It announced the results of the 1920 U.S. presidential election, and those listening, reported to be around 100 people, would know the results before anyone else. Everybody else had to wait until they would read it in the newspapers the next day. I don't think anyone in that shed atop the K building realized the impact of this on future political reporting or politics in the media. Until this moment in history, people only read about politicians and their platforms. Now they could hear them. Politicians would be able to speak directly to the people and engage with them in a way that wasn't possible before. It seems fitting that we are celebrating this anniversary on the eve of an election like no other, in a time where we can engage with politicians in ways that couldn't have been imagined 100 years ago. We receive our news within minutes of events happening. We live in a 24/7 news cycle, for better or for worse, and we've been able to share that info across the world. In this, we sometimes forget to remember our beginnings and those who came before us. This evening, I'm happy to be a part of this event and not only remembers but celebrates those historical events and people. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor.
We really
Kelly.
Appreciate you for taking your time to come here and shining the light on Turtle Creek, Pennsylvania.
Thanks.
Let me say, Mayor Kelly, that as a young man, one of my first summer jobs was at the Union Switch and Signal, part of the Westinghouse Air Brake Company. People forget, but this entire valley in some way or another was employed or shaped by Westinghouse in this spot where we are here. And more broadly, I live in a house built in 1930 in Forest Hills that was built by a Westinghouse engineer. The roots run deep all throughout this region in Pittsburgh, and so it's a great honor to have you with us tonight.
Great, thank you. Thank you very much.
I was sharing with Ken and some others the other day that we had our big economic downturn in the late 70s and 80s in Pittsburgh and a lot of the East Coast and the Midwest, and we're trying to come back from it. I remember when I was in Congress hosting Hazel O'Leary, who was the Secretary of Energy, and we were trying to talk to her about the great things that Westinghouse and other companies had done in the world of energy. And we're sitting around a table with people there from probably dozens of Pittsburgh companies meeting with the energy secretary. And we were waiting for her to arrive, and somebody looked across and they said, "Is that a Westinghouse pen?" And the guy said, "Yeah, you worked at Westinghouse?" Until we figured out everybody except one or two people at the table, myself included, had all worked at Westinghouse. So I remember the old saying used to be, when I first came from Somerset County toward Pittsburgh, if you could walk down the street in almost any town near Pittsburgh, 200 yards, you had a chance of getting a job at Westinghouse. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of, and we're going to talk to our folks from Westinghouse, sure, the retirees who were so happy that they're still involved in the community, and we're going to talk about the wonderful history of Westinghouse, George Westinghouse, and all the things that took place. Thank you for giving us your time.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Mayor. Keep up the great work.
Oh, thanks.
We're talking, and in fact, Ken and his wonderful documentary, I think, really set things up to talk about how magnificent and how earth-shattering this whole evening was 100 years ago. Because before that, it was the printed word. It was the newspaper. It was books. It was letters that were written, whereby we got most of our information. The spoken word came from people talking to one another, passing stories down from one to another. But what happened on the 2nd of November of 1920, with the establishment of the first commercial radio station in the world, changed the way information, entertainment, education, and everything would happen for the rest of our lives and on into the future. We have no idea where we're really going to go from here. So right now, this is the most important thing that we can do, and that is to relive that broadcast that took place 100 years ago.
We're back here with a surprise guest, State Senator Jay Costa Jr. Senator Costa, we're so honored to have you here. He decided that he would rather be here than see Lady Gaga, so we appreciate that, and I'm going to take off my mask now.
But Ken, that's not surprising because the senator has been involved with this project for so many years, and he has been a driving force and actually has done some good for this project in Harrisburg.
Well, I want to say that I was elected mayor of Forest Hills in 1997, so I always tell Senator Costa that I beat him to elected office.
Yes, you did.
He was elected shortly after that, but from the very earliest days when Westinghouse and CBS donated the property to Forest Hills, Senator Costa was a champion of trying to preserve that history. And as you know, Jay, we talked about many different ideas to try to save some of the history of Frank Conrad and work with all the folks involved. And we're still at it, but it has culminated in the 100-year anniversary. So just say a little about what this has meant to this whole region.
Well, this whole conversation about the 100th anniversary and this origin to the East Pittsburgh and Turtle Creek and Forest Hills communities has been outstanding, and particularly the recreation centers we know at the Westinghouse Rec Center. I remember when I first got elected into office, meeting with Rick Harris and Mrs. Sapienza and others about in the museum and the like and the work that was done. And even for a while there when all those artifacts were stored in the basement of the rec center. And it's always been a project that I've always had a great interest in, given the historical perspective that it's meant to so many people in Pennsylvania, what KDKA has meant around the world. And you know, today we're here celebrating 100th anniversary. I think it's outstanding, but it's always been something that's been important to me in this community. And I know over the years we've worked together, Ken, you and others, trying to preserve the garage and other things that have taken place. It's just been exciting to get on that path. I mean, growing up as a young person, I was one of those guys that listened to Bob Prince on the radio at nighttime, with the radio under my pillow at night, listening to baseball games in the 60s and early 70s. So good memories along those lines, but also growing up and now being involved in public life, the role that KDK plays in terms of disseminating information and talk radio and giving folks the opportunity to be a part of that, it's just really important. But knowing that this whole garage and all this stuff took place and started in our community, it's fascinating when you stop and think of it. So I'm just really happy to be a part of it.
Well, we appreciate it. Senator Costa also helped us when we began working at Duquesne University to try to work with the National Museum of Broadcasting, Rick Harris, Ron Klink, and others to preserve some of the documents and to digitize them, because it's, you know, this history will be gone if we don't take steps to preserve it. And so that's greatly appreciated to Senator Costa, because that work continues.
Yep.
It's very important for new generations to understand how all of this started, because it really is what has made possible these phones that all of the kids are walking around with and doing amazing things with, and we're trying to still learn how to use. But it all really started with the work of Frank Conrad.
And that's, which is amazing. And I know that we have been trying to ensure that we do have the artifacts, but also remember exactly what's taking place. And as folks can look back on, you know, generations now, knowing that what occurred here, you know, they talked about what's gonna happen with the news. And I think I heard someone mention earlier today that, you know, folks will be getting all their news on a handheld device more so than sitting down in front of a TV or whatever the case may be. So the world's changing, but to think it all started out of a garage over in Wilkinsburg area and the like, and what's trying to be done to preserve it, it's been outstanding. I want to thank you, Ken, because when you became president of Duquesne, we talked about this. I think some folks came to talk to you, and you and I spoke about what plans you had for 2020 with regard to recognizing this this important date. And the COVID 19 kind of prevented that from happening and coming to total fruition in terms of what we had talked about, displaying artifacts and the like throughout the university and having programming. But that's important for us to remember that. And I, you know, every time I go up to the rec center for different events, whether it be picnics or parties or whatever the case may be, or community meetings, the photographs that are on the wall always remind us where who we were and what role we played in that activity.
And many graduates of Duquesne University, students there worked in this valley at Westinghouse. Duquesne, as you know, as a graduate of Duquesne, was a university built to help recent immigrants to Pittsburgh to get an education. So there is such a deep connection. It's important to us to preserve this as well. So the work of you and all of the folks who are commemorating this event tonight really is going to have a lasting impact. We appreciate it. I did hear a rumor, Senator Costa, that Lady Gaga may come here tonight to be tomorrow night. So you're welcome to come.
I would like to come down for that. That's for sure. Yeah. I may be a little bit busy tomorrow, but during the day. But I'll find time to come for that. So thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
Senator,
thank you for having me.
Thank you.
Congressman, good seeing you again.
Good to see you.
Keep up the good work and keep delivering.
If I could mention too, I mean, we talk about the National Museum of Broadcasting, which has been struggling to really to find a home. This relationship with RIDC, we might find something here, but I want to thank you because you actually got them a grant. We have to come up with the matching money, but it's over $1 million. So if there are people out there that are watching this, others that say, you know what, this needs to be memorialized. What happened in Pittsburgh 100 years ago was so important to the information gathering. Stop and think about it. Every bit of entertainment that we've had in our lifetime came about because there was first radio.
Yeah.
And then television. And we watched the world in front of our eyes. We heard the world through our ears simply because of the vision of Frank Conrad and the people who were here. And we really need to have a permanent museum here that can memorialize this and many other inventions and things that are yet to come.
Well, I'm happy to be a part of that conversation. You know, I was thinking about, I mentioned to Ken, I think earlier, the night, I believe, that was the night that they did the first broadcast of a baseball game, I think. It was Arlen was the last name. And then two generations later, his grandson was pitching against the Pirates one day. And I remember listening to that broadcast. It was really the first time I became exposed to what Frank Conrad had done and what role KDK played along those lines. So you're right. We have to memorialize this information, memorialize what's taking place. And I'm all in trying to help develop a museum here in the Pittsburgh region. And I'm happy to facilitate a conversation with the folks here at RIDC.
That's great.
They do good work, Ron, but I will tell you, they've been the beneficiary of a lot of public investment as well. And I think it may be time for them to think about maybe giving back some of that public investment back to us here in our region. So thanks again for having me.
Nice of you to mention, just because we're both in politics, you're still in and I was for a while. The best political advice I got came from somebody who you mentioned earlier. The gunner, Bob Prince.
Oh, yeah.
We ended up, when he came back to KDK shortly before he passed away, we ended up working together. And one day in the newsroom, he said to me, Ronnie, just remember this. You may be paranoid, but it doesn't mean they're not out to get you.
That's right.
You know, that's good political advice.
Exactly right. So
well,
thank you, guys.
We appreciate your joining us tonight, yep. Senator Costa, and we look forward to working together for many years.
Looking forward to
project.
It as well.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye.
Well, we have another surprise guest here with us, and so we're happy to welcome the county executive of Allegheny County here, Rich Fitzgerald. We know you've had a busy night, Rich. I think you just came from a rally of some sort down at Heinz Field that you can, and so you did get to see Lady Gaga. This is the only one who has. But we are so honored to have you because I know how deeply you care about preserving the history of this region. You've been a big supporter of RIDC and everything that's going on here. So just want to welcome you and ask you to give us your thoughts about what this anniversary means to you.
Well, it means a lot because anybody who grew up in this town listened to this radio station and got the stories of Pittsburgh, the stories of the region and all the things that happened. When you think about, going back 100 years, the history of Pittsburgh is in many ways the history of this country and the history of the world. Growing up, you just kind of took it for granted, when you walked on for breakfast, mom had that radio on, and that's what it was on. And you think about the historic election we're going through now, and that this is how KDKA began 100 years ago with an election, an election at the time that was historic. So things sometimes go full circle. Also, when you think about, we were coming out of a pandemic, the 1918 Spanish flu, and now we're, again, 100 years later, the same thing, the COVID-19 pandemic. So KDKA is just integral as part of all of our lives for people that grew up here.
Yeah, and you've done a lot of work in this whole valley, I know, having grown up around here. You've been a great friend to the Mon Valley, the Turtle Creek Valley. So this really represents something special in our region, doesn't it?
It does. And you think of, again, the history, the industrial heritage of what has happened in this valley. The toil, the sweat, the people who came here from other parts of the world to live a better life. And through a lot of hard work and a lot of suffering and toil, et cetera, they helped build a better life for their family, for the next generation. And this valley was again a big part of it through a couple of world wars, a depression, the change in this region over the last couple of decades. But the people of this region have always, and the people of this valley have always been, get up every day, go to work, do the right thing, do better for their community, and it's special.
And I was thinking about, having worked for Westinghouse for 14 years and being very proud of that, and driving down here, I thought about the history of Westinghouse Corporation. There would be no such thing as alternating current if it wasn't for George Westinghouse, Nikola Tesla, and others. It would be, the radio certainly wouldn't be what it was. So, and that was a big political battle between General Electric and Westinghouse because they wanted direct current where you'd have a power station every few miles versus the alternating current. And I remember reading the story about how they electrocuted an elephant to scare people into saying that the alternating current was too dangerous for you. But we think, Rich, about the Westinghouse is just one of those companies which no longer exists here in Pittsburgh. And how many small towns across western Pennsylvania had a Westinghouse facility of one kind or another? And it's leaders like you and Mike Doyle and the mayor and others who have to help us figure out how do we build upon the foundation of great companies like Westinghouse and move Pittsburgh into the future. I'm sure that you deal with thoughts about this day in and day out.
Yeah, you do, and you think about Westinghouse, you're exactly right. I mean, when George Westinghouse came here and developed the air brake and then obviously all the patents with electricity and all the things that he has developed, it's part of not just our history, but the history of this country, the industrialization of this country. There's still a lot of Westinghouse companies out there that have spun off. You think about Curtis Wright, we think about Wabco, one of the big announcements that they just made about an investment they're going to make out at our airport on the neighborhood 91. It's one of the worldwide companies, and they've bought a lot of, they bought GE Locomotive and other companies. So their roots are still here. the roots of engineering, the roots of science, the roots of entrepreneurship in developing, you know, the next generation of technology that has been, again, part of what we do here in Westinghouse is a huge, huge part of it. You think of towns like Wilmerding, like Turtle Creek, like East Pittsburgh, North Braddock, that so many people who worked in the factories that made all the products that were there. It's just a big part of us.
And I would say one of the interesting things, Rich, we watched a documentary before this. Frank Conrad had a seventh grade education. He went on to become chief engineer at Westinghouse. You're an engineer by training. You know what a remarkable accomplishment that he invented all of this technology and all of the science that was necessary to do this. Today, I would like to think that we are using our universities that you have always been such a great supporter of to try to push us into those new areas, to try to invent the future. And I do think that Pittsburgh and Allegheny County and this region, with its great universities, with its great history of innovation, really is poised to do more great things.
I think you're absolutely right. And we're literally standing on the shoulders of Westinghouse and the industrialization that happened years ago. You know, now it's Facebook and Argo AI and Uber and driverless cars and robotics and, you know, information technology and all the things that are happening. But that groundbreaking thing, you know, 100 years ago was truly groundbreaking, and which you could communicate with the world through this thing called radio, and Westinghouse developing it and being part of it. So what Frank Conrad did, again, he goes down, you know, with the Starzls and the Carnegies and the Fricks and all the, you know, the folks that we've in the Westinghouse is looking upon our history and the folks that made this region what it is. And their impact was certainly far beyond just this region throughout the world.
But it's the capturing of that radio wave is what's going to create the driverless cars.
Yes.
It's going to create the AI. This is the next chapter in that book that was started 100 years ago.
Because most scientists and most engineers or whatever, they don't start from the very beginning. They build upon the idea that somebody else generated, and then they take it to the next level. And that's exactly what's happening right now. And when you think about, again, where we came from as a community and as a region, you know, Pittsburgh and the region was going like this for a long, long time. And then in the 80s, we kind of hit a little bit of a, you know, downswell. It lasts for a couple of decades. But now I think the trajectory is again on the upswing. And Ken, you're exactly right. The universities really have become drivers of the innovation that then spins out the next idea that becomes the next factory, the next research and development lab that creates the opportunities that bring people here. It's a new generation of Pittsburghers that are coming here from around the world. Why are they coming here? Opportunities. The opportunities that were here 100 years ago that brought, you know, our parents and grandparents here.
And we're going to move to a reenactment of the events from that night. But before you leave, I just want to say I think we all agree that it is people like you and Senator Costa and Congressman Doyle, who we read remarks from, and Mayor Bill Peduto, who are truly taking us on that upswing right now. I think we have something very special in this region. We appreciate your leadership, and we do see amazing things on the horizon thanks to all of your efforts.
Well, and again, I think it's a partnership. You mentioned all those individuals, and they're a big part of what we do. So from the government sector, whether it's our partners in Washington, whether it's our partners in Harrisburg locally, working with our corporate community, the Westinghouse of today, along with our universities, which are, you know, as prominent now as they've been at any point in our history. And it's all the folks working together, including our labor community that also is partnering with us to move this region forward, because it's the men and women that are going to be doing the work, that go to work every day, that create this, whether they're working in a factory, whether they're working in a laboratory, whether they're working in a classroom doing the next, you know, inventing the next technology that's going to improve people's lives. And it's an exciting thing to be part of.
Well, you Rich, you lived through it. We kind of fluffed over it, but when you talked about the downturn that took place beginning in the 1980s, that we kind of fluffed over, but the reality was when you go into a community and that factory or that steel mill shuts down, and there are thousands of people who lost their jobs, when generations of one family worked there, you can feel the depression in the air. I covered it when I was doing news. And you know, if you own a store in that town, a business in that town, a home in that town, you know that the value that you've put your entire livelihood into is gone.
Yep.
It's not good anymore. I remember being in Clareton when they closed the police department down. I mean, these are the kinds of things that happen. It would have been very easy for us to stay down when we got knocked down. But because we had good universities, and we had good political leadership, and we had people in the private sector that did work together, that's what's really caused this to happen. But it took the brains of somebody like Frank Conrad and George Westinghouse to be able to give us the foundation to build on.
Yeah, and I think what most of us who've grown up here, and you know, both of you and myself, we know how special this place is. So even during our toughest times, people wanted to stay. I mean, a lot of people did have to leave, unfortunately, but many people toughed it out. They wanted to stay. They stayed for their families. They stayed for this great community. And luckily, the future right now looks very bright. You know, never take it for granted, because you got to keep working at it. You got to work at it every day. But you know, again, things look good. And you think about someone like Frank Conrad. It's good that we honor and remember, you know, what he has done and what he, the legacy he's left for all of us to build upon.
Well, with that, I think we'll lead into the reenactment if you'd like, Ron, but we really appreciate your coming tonight.
Thank you, County Executive Richard Fitzgerald.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
Electric and Manufacturing Company in East Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. We shall now broadcast the election returns. We are receiving these returns through the cooperation and by special arrangements with the Pittsburgh Post and Sun. The election returns will be broadcast as soon as they are received by us here at KDKA. We'd appreciate it if anyone hearing this broadcast would communicate with us, as we are very anxious to know how far the broadcast is reaching and how it is being received. Write your card or letter to station KDKA, East Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And now, while we're waiting for the returns to come in over the telephone, direct from the Post and Sun, I'll give you the list of offices in today's presidential election. Here they are. Some 30 million Americans are electing a President of the United States, a Vice President, 34 United States Senators, 435 members of the House of Representatives, governors of 34 states, and thousands of minor offices, county judges, and officials. Okay, so those are the offices to be filled. And here are the seven complete presidential tickets that are being voted on. I guess you all know these names pretty well by this time, but there's no harm repeating them, and we have to wait for the returns anyway. So here's the list. Republican, Warren G. Harding and Calvin Coolidge. Democratic, James M. Cox and Franklin D. Roosevelt. Socialist, Eugene V. Debs and Seymour Stedman. Prohibition, Aaron S. Watkins and Leigh Colvin. Farmer Labor, Parley S. Christensen and Max S. Hayes. Socialist Labor Party, William Cox and August Gilhouse. And Single Tax, R.C. McCauley and R.C. Barnum. Well, those are the candidates running for the various offices in this election, and we're going to stay right here and broadcast the returns as they come into us, so please stand by.
And here is an item about President Wilson After reviewing the early election returns, President Wilson retired to his bedroom at 9 p.m. tonight and was asleep a half an hour later. It is now passed that the Republican ticket of Harding and Coolidge is running well ahead of Cox and Roosevelt. At the present time, Harding has collected more than 16 million votes against some 9 million for the Democrats. Oh, just a minute. A bulletin just came in. I will read it to you. Democratic candidate James M. Cox and his chief manager, Chairman White, of the Democratic National Committee have conceded the election to Senator Harding. Yes, sir, the election is conceded by Cox to Harding, and it looks like Warren G. Harding and Calvin Coolidge are the men who will be the bearers of our nation for the next 4 years. Of course, don't forget, all of the returns are not in by any manner of means, so stand by. We will give them to you as they come in, so you will have the complete story as we broadcast.
G. Harding has swept the presidency with the largest popular majority in history, which included women of all states for the first time, which added millions to the total vote. The greatest popular vote in the history of American politics and the largest electoral vote ever rolled up by a Republican candidate. Harding's electoral vote had reached 391 with indications that the doubtful states could carry that total to the 400 mark. And so here are the incomplete returns again. Harding, 391 electoral votes, and Cox, 127. Now, before we leave you, I would like to ask all those who heard this broadcast to communicate with us, telling us how it was received. Once again, we are anxious to know how far the broadcast was received. Just send a card or letter to KDKA, East Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. This is KDKA of the Westinghouse Electric and Manufacturing Company, East Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, signing off until 7 p.m. this evening.
and down the street. Now I ask you very confidently, ain't he sweet? Ain't he nice? Look over once or twice. Now I ask you very confidently, ain't he nice? Just cast an eye in her direction. Oh, me, oh, my, ain't that perfection? I repeat, don't speak that kind of neat. And I ask you very confidently,
we are very happy tonight to have with us another guest who's coming with us over the airwaves of Zoom. So we're using a lot of high tech tonight for a couple of guys talking about the very first radio broadcast 100 years ago. With us is former Senator Gordon Smith. Senator Smith is the president and CEO of the National Association of Broadcasters. The trade group represents the interests of local radio and TV stations throughout the country, as well as the big four broadcasting networks. Senator Smith has been a very strong voice for broadcasters when he was in the Senate, and now with the National Association of Broadcasters. He's been an outspoken champion of local news and local broadcast. And prior to joining the NAB in 2009, he was a two-term United States Senator from his home state of Oregon, the moderate Republican. And among his legislative accomplishments was the enactment of the Garrett Lee Smith Memorial Act, named for his late son, authorizing a funding for suicide prevention and awareness programs at colleges. And Senator, if I remember correctly, you ran for the U.S. Senate twice in the same year. Am I correct about
that? Congressman, yes, that happens to be true. When I ran for the Packwood seat in a special election and narrowly lost to a man who is now, and was even then a friend, now a very good friend, Ron Wyden. Yep. It was a very close election. And then 6 months later, I just kept running, and I won the Hatfield seat, where I was privileged to serve for two terms. And I love being connected to Pittsburgh because one of my dearest friends in life is Orrin Hatch, and he's a Pittsburgh native and a dear friend still. And I used to go, it seems like several times a year, from Oregon to sell vegetables to the H.J. Hines company there in Pittsburgh. So I love your city, and I'm a fan of your successor, Congressman Doyle. He's been really a great guy to work with.
Yeah, he certainly
on the
is.
Issues of importance to broadcasting.
Well, Senator, give us your thoughts. I'm sure you've had time to think about the 100th anniversary of the first commercial radio broadcast. What are your thoughts as you look back and look ahead?
You know, Congressman, I'm blown away by the high privilege I have to be at the running NAB at CEO at the 100th anniversary. And I'm reminded by the circumstances how many times history tends to repeat itself. You know, if radio were invented today, it would be seen as miraculous today as it was when it was invented and commercialized 100 years ago. But when it happened, right there at KDKA, we were in the middle of a pandemic. We were in a time of great political tumult, and we elected a president who ran on the theme of return to normalcy. And I can't help but think that that's somewhat of a pervading sort of undergirding of the current political environment, is just a hunger for some normalcy. But you think also, Congressman, of all of the businesses, the industries that have come and gone in the last 100 years, and yet this one remains, continuing to add to the quality of the American life and our civic experience, and benefits people in so many ways, and yet its future is still very bright, despite all the new telecommunications that exist. So what happened in Pittsburgh 100 years ago tonight is not just historic, it adds so measurably to the quality of life of the American people. And so much good has come of it.
President Gormley.
Senator Smith, my name is Ken Gormley. I'm the president of Duquesne University here, so it's an honor to be with you. I actually grew up with Mike Doyle here in Swissvale, in these communities here in these mill towns, and my law school roommate was now Senator Mark Warner, who, you know, made his fortune. He came from a modest background like the rest of us and made his fortune in then a little known business called cellular telephone. And so
yes,
we see
indeed.
How communications has really defined our country in so many ways, and we appreciate all the efforts that you have undertaken to advance this important industry. So for the last 40 years at least, broadcasters have been facing increasing competition from the little days when KDKA was just kind of a lone and a giant here, for instance, in Pittsburgh, but first from cable and satellite radio, and then from the internet competing with it. So in light of that competition, how are the businesses of radio and TV broadcasting faring these days?
Well, President, first let me compliment you on your great university. Your question is wonderful. I mean, as I think of Mark Warner, who I know very well, we all love our cell phones, and they have added also to our life in positive ways. And so the question that really is, why is radio still around? And the reason it's still around is because it has an architecture, a technology that, despite all of the competition from cable and satellite and cell phones and the internet, most of which are in one way or another subscription services, our unique franchise is the reason we continue not just to survive, but to thrive. And that is, we're live and we're local and we're free. And it's really hard to beat free, so that anybody who wants to connect with the outside world with just a little antenna, what KDKA showed is that you can reconnect with the world free through radio. And so radio and television still are the best ways to move commerce. They're a better way in an emergency to get information, because these cell phones all clog down and get jammed, but that broadcast signal of one to everyone, it's just a miraculous thing. And it's unique to us. And so when it comes to the best programming, the necessary civic news and information, the best entertainment content, and in this day and age, as well as past, that emergency signal that despite earthquakes or hurricanes or tornadoes, our signal stays up when all the others get knocked down. And that's because broadcast architecture of one to everyone. There's nothing like it in the world except radio and television.
And so what role do you see television playing in the next decade, AM and FM radio playing in the next decade?
Well, I think that they will evolve, and you will see many of my thousands of radio members at the NAB. They still use the terrestrial signal. That's their main business. And it's based on advertising. And that's how it's funded. But they also put up digital platforms, because the heart of every broadcaster, and this is really true of radio, is the heart of a public servant, like the congressman there. And they want to be on every platform that a listener may want to be on, whenever and wherever they may be. And so you see radio investing in other platforms and simulcasting their content so that they're always there for their customer, their listener. And so whether it's radio or television, I just think that the uniqueness of live, local, and free means we're going to be around.
And it's really interesting, Senator, because surveys do show that still local TV stations are the most trusted source of news. Why is it? How do you keep that trust? I grew up at a time, as I'm sure you did, when the newscasters in this town were right up there with the judges and the respected political figures. They were institutions. They still are, especially in a town like Pittsburgh. How do you continue that trust?
Well, I'll tell you, I'll get to the reason for it, but I will bet Congressman Klink would agree with me that when he would go home to Pittsburgh and I would go home to Oregon, I knew when I would go to the studio of a radio station or a television station that I was dealing with people who lived in my community and who just wanted the facts. And they weren't trying to spin me on some partisan shout show on a cable network. They just wanted to serve their local community. And because of that, the surveys that you note, they continue to make clear that we remain the most trusted source of news. Because, well, I serve long and well with Chuck Schumer, and Chuck, I recently had him speak to the broadcasters of this country. And he said he was worried about our democracy because so much of the news business, the cable business, the satellite business, the internet, was all filed off in such a partisan way that he was beginning to feel that the only connectivity to civility in our civic life was local broadcasters of radio and television, which is when he would go to those stations in New York, no one was trying to spin him. They were trying to serve the people that were their neighbors. And that's why I think we are the most trusted and will continue to be necessary in the firmament of telecommunications. And that's our, again, that's our franchise, and we hold it uniquely. Because if you want a local story, you're not gonna get it from satellite. You're gonna get it from a broadcast feed to a satellite station or a cable station. We're on the ground, we're live, we're local, and we're free.
Well, Senator, you know, if you stick around long enough, things become in a circle. When I first started working at the CBS affiliate in Pittsburgh, we didn't have cable in Pittsburgh. And I remember when they did the first cable agreement. And of course, the audience divided. My kids are millennials. Them and kids younger than them now are cutting the cable and they're going back to antennas and other digital receivers so that they can watch. How do you account for that? Is it strictly financial? What do you forecast as the future? Is this a wave of things to come?
Yeah, I really believe it is, Congressman, and I think the future is not broadband or broadcast. It's both. I'm asked a lot, don't people want to watch or listen when they want to watch or listen? And doesn't that spell doom for broadcasting? And I said, absolutely not, because they want to watch what they want when they want it and where they want it. And so you've got to have different platforms and devices, and you've got to be on digital, you got to be on cable, you got to be on satellite. But it starts with the broadcaster, where the viewership is still way higher than any other platform. And I just think it's really important that, again, we remember the fundamentals, the reason for our success, our durability, and our continued value to the American people. And it starts with what happened 100 years ago in Pittsburgh. And it is that local connection. It is that free access. And we're going to have to compete more, but I believe we will. And millennials, you can't watch 200 TV stations. So with an antenna in the digital age, you put up a digital antenna here in Washington, D.C., that'll get you 40 stations. I don't know what it is in Pittsburgh. I'll bet it's 20. How much time do you have to watch anything that long? And when you want to watch something that's happening now, like the Oscars or the Super Bowl or the World Series, you don't want to watch a rerun, you want to watch it live. And that is our franchise.
And do you see that continuing to be available on broadcast TV for free, as you said, or is that going, the competition going to become so fierce that that will become impossible?
There's no question that the competition will be more fierce. And we and broadcasters have to have scale to compete with all the other offerings of, they're called the FANG companies, the Facebook, Apple, Amazon, Google, or Netflix, Google, it equals FANG. And it's gonna be more difficult. But in the end, we are the content that people are looking for, that local live content. And sports certainly keeps us very relevant. And I think we just have to have the scale and understand that the people still, even though we've taken for granted, they still want what we do. And they will still tune in to us because of the way we bring it to them.
Ron, you're the expert on, do you want to ask about next gen TV? Because that's an interesting thing.
Well, yeah, what is happening with, we keep hearing about next gen TV. What can you give us a peek behind the curtain, as it were, and tell the people that are fortunate
Absolutely.
Enough to be watching tonight, what can we expect?
I'm trying to remember, Congressman, if we overlapped, I was on the Senate from 96 to 2009.
Yeah, we did. I left in 2000.
Okay, so we did overlap. And what you will remember, Congressman, that high definition came on in your time and in mine. I was on the Senate Commerce Committee when we were trying to force the transition. Well, what next gen is the step up from high definition. So you probably heard of 4K and 8K pictures that are basically so vibrant, so clear that it's three-dimensional without the 3D glasses. But next gen gives us the ability to broadcast in 4K and perhaps 8K. Because of digital compression. And it also allows us to provide the listener with immersive sound if they want it. And it has such a new investment in our spectrum that it makes mobility very possible. So that, for example, if you had a device with an antenna inside of it, you could pick up a broadcast signal, which means you don't have to stream it. You get broadcast locally for free. And I think that this is something that the Congress will grapple with. It's a voluntary thing that the FCC has approved and the Congress supports. So better pictures even than what we have now, immersive sound, mobility, and interactivity through broadband. So broadcast and broadband are linked in a way that will provide tremendous new optionalities to viewers and to broadcasters. And so the future is just really rather bright if we get to this next stage, and the government will do its part to help foster it and push it along as it did with HD, but probably not in a mandatory way as it did with HD.
So you remind me that I was on Energy and Commerce and on the Telecom Subcommittee, we were doing the 98 Telecom Act. We were rewriting the 1934 Act that had been written before television was invented.
Yes.
And then in 98, we were writing something that was looking forward, and I would venture to say very few of the members in either the House or Senate were using the internet. Certainly very few were emailing at that time. So it was, you know, we're trying to think ahead. It's a difficult thing for legislators and for government to try to write rules for something that you're not even sure where the industry is going to go.
No, it is true, and that's why, you know, frankly, the big challenge of the next Congress and the next president is going to be, what do you do with all these antiquated rules that bind down broadcasting, but which are not applied to new entrants into telecommunications like Facebook and Twitter? You see all of the fighting that's going on around those. It's because they're free to do anything, and these are becoming huge monopolies, not unlike the robber barons that Teddy Roosevelt and Woodrow Wilson decried and fought against. And there's some big decisions that have to be made, but the point I want your viewers and listeners to understand, we're not asking for them to be burdened with regulations, but put broadcasting on an even playing field with them. Because we can compete because of our architecture and the content that we provide. It's just content that people want, like live sporting events, just as one example. And so we really are just asking the Supreme Court, the administration, and the Congress, the FCC, to remember the unique public values that are driven by a broadcast license of children's programming, of civic decency, of no indecency, a place where families can go, a place that covers local news and provides emergency warnings and things like that. We do that uniquely, and most of these subscription services, they're free to run wild, and they have no restrictions, so they take our content and they sell ads on the basis of our content that are ultimately taking resources away from local broadcasters, local journalism, and civic life. So there's some rebalancing that government needs to do, just as it did in the days of KDKA when the FCC was created and took it from the Commerce Department to license airwaves. We just need them to pay attention and to create a fair future that will preserve the basic policy values that broadcasters uniquely provide to the American people.
So, Senator, speaking of the future, a last question for you. We just had the reenactment, so we now know who won the Harding-Cox election of 1920. I'll tell you, if you didn't know, it was Warren Harding by a landslide. You were in public life, you were a U.S. Senator. Do you have any predictions of who is going to win tomorrow night in the Trump-Biden election of 2020?
Well, I'll tell you, if it isn't Joe Biden, then the polling community needs to get a new job, because all of the legitimate pollsters that I credit and follow make it clear that Joe Biden has somewhere between a 6, 7, 8 point lead nationally. That isn't true of every battleground state, and we don't elect a president based on the popular vote. But a job approval number for an incumbent is usually, almost always, the percent of the popular vote that they will get. And President Trump, for reasons of his own management style and commentary, he's basically at somewhere around 44%. The last president reelected who had a job approval number under 50% was George W. Bush, and he was at 48%. And so he barely beat John Kerry at 48%. And so if President Trump wins on Electoral College by threading that needle again, it's going to be on the razor's edge. But it's really hard for me to see how, if the polling is right, 44% can translate into 270 Electoral College votes. I don't think it ever has before.
Thank you for a straightforward answer.
I think he's likely the next president, but I do have this funny feeling again that I had in 2016 that there's something going on out there, and President Trump is working really hard, and there is an enthusiasm in his base. Whether it's enough to make the difference, I don't know, but the polling business they're gonna have to find new jobs if they miss it this time.
Well, I'm the author of a book called The Presidents and the Constitution, and so there's a chapter on every president. I've studied this subject. My guess is, if things go the way the pollsters are saying, as you have suggested, the takeaway from this presidency will be that you cannot win or retain the presidency focused entirely on 42% of the population.
That's true.
Yeah, I've never understood the focus just on your political base. And Karl Rove was very much sort of the architect of that for George W. Bush, and it worked in that instance. But the problem is, neither the Republicans or the Democrats have a 51% registration in this country. And so it is that 10 to 15% in the middle that maybe is persuadable to go one way or the other. That will ultimately determine who's going to get 270 electoral votes. And I don't know President Trump. I served elbow to elbow with Joe Biden for 8 years on the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, so I know him very well. And he was a moderate Democrat to my mind. I was a moderate Republican from Oregon, so that probably put me to the left of him. But we got along great. I just feel badly that Joe is a much more fragile 78 than I remembered him as a 68. And well, it is what it is.
Rumor has it that the
country's hungry for normalcy.
Rumor has it, Senator, that that happens to all of us as we age.
Yes, happening to me.
But we appreciate, we're going to get back to some more historical recollections on this very important night in American history, but we really appreciate your joining us to lend your insights. It means a great deal.
You've been very gracious, Senator. Thank you.
Well, thank you both so much, gentlemen. I have been on ever since 7 o'clock, and I have loved what you've shared and what you're doing here, and all of the National Association of Broadcasters. We thank you for this wonderful celebration tonight.
We appreciate it. We look forward to your visiting in person when that's possible. And maybe we'll start working on those multi-million-dollar grants to build the museum here.
We would like that, and would love to come. I remember just a little radio story. I was an 8-year-old boy who loved Vernon Law because of my parents were Mormons, and so was he.
Yep.
And listening on a little transistor, the 1960 World Series, and Mazeroski's home run in the ninth, I heard that live, and I heard it live because of radio. So thank you, Pittsburgh.
God bless you.
Thank
Take
you
care.
Very much. Thanks, Senator.
Things like third dimension, yet we get a trifle weary with Mr. Einstein's theory. So we must get down to earth at times, relax, relieve the tension. No matter what the progress or what may yet be proved, the simple facts of life are such, they cannot be removed. You must remember this, a kiss is still a kiss, a sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental things apply as time goes by. When two lovers woo, they still say, I love you. On that you can rely. No matter what the future brings, as time goes by. Moonlight and love songs. Never out of date, hearts full of passion, jealousy and hate. Woman needs man, and man must have his mate, that no one can deny. It's still the same old story, a fight for love and glory, a case of do or die. And the world will always welcome.
Well, we're back again, and thank you so much for those of you who have chosen to honor the invention of commercial radio, the first commercial radio station KDKA. We are here very close to where the original station first broadcast from on the second day of November of 1920. We're here on the second day of November of 2020. That was the Harding-Cox election. This is on the eve of the Trump and Biden election. We're here at a facility that was the Westinghouse electric facility, but is now run by the RIDC. And the man who is with us now is the president of the RIDC, Don F. Smith, Jr. Don is nationally recognized as an expert in regional economic development with a wide variety of work experience at the local, regional, state, and national levels. He has led roles in strategic economic development initiatives. That's really been his hallmark of his career. Some of the places that he's worked here locally, you've heard of the Pittsburgh Digital Greenhouse. He was there, the Life Sciences Greenhouse. He has held nationally unique role as the VP of Economic Development for both Carnegie Mellon University and the University of Pittsburgh. I could go on and on. He's done a lot of great things, but I'm anxious to talk to him. And to first of all, Don, thank you for making this broadcast possible. We wouldn't have a home to do this. We had all kind of plans with our other partner, Duquesne University, and the COVID got in the way. But your folks have stepped up. They have been unbelievably hardworking, accommodating, bright. I couldn't say enough expletives about how wonderful they've been. So thank you for doing this.
No, thank you. And we're really excited to be a part of this really historic occasion. And this site played an important role in that. We're happy to provide a little space to recreate that here. And Westinghouse has been a great partner through the years with RIDC. And we're here where a lot of the magic happened for Westinghouse, where it happened for broadcast, and where we're trying to continue to help it happen with new companies here at Keystone Commons.
We were talking earlier when we had Rich Fitzgerald here and Senator Cost and others about the downturn in the economy in the area. And I made the comment then, the easiest thing to do when you're knocked down is to stay down. The hard thing is to get up and get up with purpose. And RIDC has been a big part of the region being able to get up with purpose. We've had great leadership politically. We've had great leadership through our corporations. Can you talk a little bit about what it needed to be overcome? Because we had in towns all throughout the area a lot of brownfield sites, factories that were no longer there, where thousands and thousands of people had supported families working there, and all of a sudden it was an eyesore. Where do you begin, and how has this come together?
Well, I think the first thing that I think you have to start with is the spirit of the Pittsburgh people. We're really a tough and resilient place, and people don't give up here. They have a lot of pride in the community, and they work really hard. And with hard work and pride and a commitment, you can accomplish a lot. And I think that's what's happened here. But I remember very vividly, I didn't grow up in Pittsburgh, so full disclosure, I'm not a native. I grew up in the northeastern part of the state, and I came out here in 1986 to go to an incubator conference in Glassport. And I drove through Turtle Creek and Duquesne and McKeesport on my way down there, and frankly, I was stunned. Yeah. I had never seen anything like the dislocation that had happened here. And you drive that same stretch today, and you see new buildings, and you see new companies, and you know, we still have a ways to go. We still have work to do. But there's been so much good stuff that's happened. And, you know, RIDC has really been pleased to be a part of that for 65 plus years now. Really, as a lot of people don't understand what we do, we're not government. We're a private organization, but we're not for profit. So we do development, but we do development where the public payoff, like redoing Keystone Commons from the Westinghouse plant and rebuilding the jobs and the tax base that we're here, are greater than the private payout. We don't have investors that we have to give returns to, and so it allows us to take a different approach to redevelopment than private developers do or the government does. We like to think we bring the best of both worlds to the table. And since you brought up COVID, I mean, at the RIDC, we talk about, we have our own PPP program that we've been working for 65 years, and it's patience, partnership, and packaging. And so you look at Keystone Commons, we had to take a long view and a patient approach, one building at a time, rebuild it, one company at a time, recreate those jobs. And we can't do it without the partners. I know Senator Costa was here, mm-hmm. County Executive Fitzgerald was here, and numerous governors along the way. All those public programs have been really essential to helping us do this, as well as the communities of East Pittsburgh and Turtle Creek and their leadership. And then we package. We take our cash and we take rent from our tenants and we work with the public programs and we put it all together with banks and others and ways to do creative projects that appear daunting or impossible. But if you take that patient approach, you have the right partners and you can package those resources, you can make some good things happen.
I remember, you know, the Westinghouse plant here. I remember when I was at KDKA, I did a story, and it had already seen a downturn, but I don't remember the exact numbers, but it was 40 or 50,000 people that worked here at one time. And they talked about the fact that what the predecessor of PNC, Pittsburgh National Bank, actually had a bank located here. Yeah. That's how many paychecks they issued. They had a branch bank in the factory. So when you have that large of a factory that's shut down, it's this gigantic hulk in the middle of a valley, and as we talked about earlier, some families leave, other families stay, the community begins to fall apart, and you really have to, with the RIDC, figure out how you keep all of that together. And I guess that means that you're a cog in a wheel with different levels of government and different other companies that have survived.
Yeah, it really is. It's a multifaceted approach that we have to take, and we certainly partner with the communities. But one of the things that, you know, we've done in the last 10 years in particular is we've focused on the physical appearance of the properties. So the landscaping, the painting, the sidewalks, really kind of upping the look of the place to restore some of that community pride and to make it feel like a place where investment's happening and where there's vitality and where people want to be. And so early on, it was just about, you know, can we get some jobs in here? Can we get companies and try to rebuild the tax base? But more and more these days, it's about creating a sense of place and a place that people want to be and a place that companies want to be. And we sort of sit at the middle of that network with the public sector, the private sector, and the communities and pull those resources together to try to make these things happen.
How much does the fact that the history of what, because we're here to talk about history, the fact that, you know, you had Westinghouse air brake that was founded here in the valley, you had all of the different inventions of George Westinghouse and his engineers, and we talked about alternating current, of course, the first radio station. What is the heritage of all of those things like to play into as you move into the future and you try to attract other investors to come in and to have their companies take part in these facilities?
I think it's actually a great calling card for us, and it's a great selling point. One of the things, you know, I'm no longer one of the young guns in this industry, but I work with a lot of the young people at RIDC and a lot of the startup companies that we work with, and they're really about authenticity, and they love the fact that these places have that history, that Westinghouse was here, that those big turbine manufacturing lines were here right in this facility where now we have people doing technology-based robotics or software or life science kinds of things. And you can't recreate a structure like this. You just can't build something right like this today. So it gives us a unique angle to sell and to attract. And I think it also just people feel good about this is a place that made stuff and it made creative stuff. And I think we're still seeing the benefits of all the engineering talent that was assembled here over the years by companies like Westinghouse, now playing out in other startup companies, whether it's robotics and autonomous vehicles. They're still engineering driven. They're working off that same ethos that made Westinghouse successful, is making our current crop of startup companies successful.
So all the innovations that came out of a company like Westinghouse, we talked about Frank Conrad, seventh grade education, got over 200 patents. It's amazing. And there were other Frank Conrads that worked for George Westinghouse. The innovations that came out of those minds, those Westinghouse engineers for generations, where are those innovations being done today around the Pittsburgh area?
Well, certainly there are still some happening in private companies. So we have some big companies that are putting a lot of money into R&D. But increasingly what we're seeing is our universities are driving things, whether it's Carnegie Mellon and Pitt and Duquesne, the research universities, But even on the Point Parks and the Robert Morrises and the Waynesburgs and the Alleghenies, they're really training the next wave of innovators and the workers who are going to be on the shop floor creating that next breakthrough, the ones who are powering the autonomous vehicle companies, the medical device companies, the software. And so we've been really very, very lucky in this region that we have those really strong universities. And interestingly, you know, autonomous vehicles being one of the things that's clearly put Pittsburgh on the map from a technology side, it was Westinghouse that invested in Carnegie Mellon to create the Robotics Institute. There's a gentleman named Tom Murren, who was a vice president at the time, great guy, and ended up at Duquesne University as dean of the business school. But it was his foresight back in the 80s to get Westinghouse to invest in Carnegie Mellon in robotics, this new technology that is now bearing all this fruit decades later, where we're seeing that pipeline of companies and students and technologies coming out of the universities and growing here. And I think that's the other point about Westinghouse. They didn't just invent new things, they made them here. And that's how we get this broad-based economic prosperity, is we turn those innovations into products that we manufacture here, and that's what helps us get the big jobs that go to every part of the community, not just the grads from the top universities.
So can you give us some hope then? It sounds like you can. Our best days are not behind us. Innovation still being done in the Pittsburgh area?
I think our best days are definitely ahead of us. And Pittsburgh has such a proud history and such a great history of achievement and innovation. But when you look at the strength of Carnegie Mellon in the robotics, the AI, the software, the engineering, you look at Pitt and its and UPMC and AHN and all the strength in life sciences and biotechnology and medical devices, when you see those kinds of things and you talk to the companies that are being started and are growing here and their energy and their enthusiasm, really what we need to do is we just need to keep putting fuel on that fire. We need to support these companies. We need to support the universities. We need to support the students coming out of the universities. We really need to make sure that this is a place where we are the most welcoming community for innovators, for investors, and for the companies that turn those innovations into jobs and taxes in our region. And so if we just keep focusing on how we can be the best place to do all these innovative technologies and bring them to market, there's no question in my mind we'll be successful.
Do we have the venture capital in Pittsburgh that they have in other areas to help to finance these ventures?
We don't, but we're starting to see more interest from venture capital outside the region coming in and investing, in part because, you know, for decades now, Pittsburgh's been an undiscovered gem. And so whereas in Silicon Valley, you might have 10 venture capitalists fighting for the same deal, bidding the price up, in Pittsburgh, you have your pick of the litter. You can come in and pick the best companies. And so you see a company like Duolingo, which has attracted huge amounts of capital from outside our region and doing great things on the language technology software side. If you look at Aurora Innovations or Argo or the autonomous vehicle companies, you're seeing $500 million, billion, $2 billion investments in these companies.
Wow.
Because they're doing such exciting, game-changing things. And people are starting to understand that Pittsburgh's a place where you can do these great things and you can make the future happen.
You can't always go out and find the ideas, but you can go out and find the money.
You can find the money. It moves easier than the ideas and the people.
Yeah, for sure. Sure. Don F. Smith, Jr., RIDC, it's a pleasure to meet you. Nice to talk to you. And I hope we have more time to talk in the future.
Thanks very much.
Take care. All right. Now, when you hear this next voice, we're going to put a face with it, and then you're going to say, oh, my goodness, that's who that is. So Susie Barber has been on the air in Pittsburgh for almost two decades. She's been around here doing a lot more than that. She is now the Director of Communications for Westinghouse Sure. Sure is a nonprofit group of Westinghouse retirees dedicated to volunteer activities and giving back to their communities in their retirement. And I just say this about that. If it wasn't for Westinghouse Sure and Susie Barber getting in contact with me, none of this would be occurring. She stepped up, just like she stepped up to the microphone, and she got her organization involved, and along with RIDC and Duquesne University and other sponsors, that's how this whole thing came about. So, Susie, we owe you a real debt of gratitude for really putting us together and bringing Sure to the table to make this happen.
Well, it's a love project for us because we were have long embraced the wonderful talents of men like Frank Conrad and the things that he had done. And of course, I sort of wore two hats because I worked at KDKA Radio for 19 years.
You did.
And then in addition, worked at Westinghouse headquarters for nearly 6 years.
Doing communications, correct?
Yes, doing communications. Right. And then was eventually, then my career led me elsewhere, but I still maintained my love of the whole Westinghouse persona. I felt like when we were there, it was such a camaraderie working for that organization. Yeah. And even though it was years and years later, after we had lost George Westinghouse, his legacy sort of lived on. And that's what's important to Westinghouse Sure as an organization, which, by the way, was founded in 1989 as part of the George H.W. Bush Thousand Points of Light.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I remember it well.
To get more involved and do more and give back to the community. And Pittsburghers are always been that way, I believe. And our organization was formed with some help from the headquarters of Westinghouse because they saw the value of doing that. And we've humbly come along to the point where we had about 900 members. That doesn't include spouses. They're also part of things, and there mm-hmm. many of them are volunteers as well. And over the time that we've been in business as a nonprofit organization, no one's paid a penny, and we have put together in 31 years over 1.3 million volunteer hours that our people give back to the community. So we're pretty proud of that.
No, you should be. Well, there are a lot of people out there that don't know, they know Westinghouse.
Yeah.
But probably a lot of people don't even know there was a George Westinghouse. But he was really quite extraordinary.
Oh,
can you talk about him?
Oh, my gosh. Well, it's, you know, we're celebrating the 100th year of the first broadcast. But this last month was the 90th anniversary of the George Westinghouse Memorial being erected in Schenley Park. And the money to build that memorial, which is now 90 years old, was put together by employees donating about a dollar or whatever they could spare because they so loved this man. And this was, he died in 1914. The memorial was never finished until, of course, City of Pittsburgh got involved and started happening, helped make it happen, as well as the mayor back then. And eventually it took a few years to build, but then it opened in 1930 with about 20,000 people in attendance there for the unveiling of this great statue. Westinghouse Sure got involved a few years ago. We had a rededication of the whole memorial, and people like George Westinghouse IV showed up for it, and of course many, many dignitaries. But it just sort of, to me, epitomizes the legacy of this man, how beloved he was to his employees even back then.
Well, he invented a lot of benefits. The weekend, the paid vacations, insurance.
It was unheard of that you would give an employee a half a day off on a Saturday. So think how attractive that would be if you were looking for a place to work. Hey, I can be home on Saturday night, you know, with the family. And, you know, even a town like Wilmerding was one of those. And in this area in the valley here, there were lots of homes that were built and constructed by Westinghouse and then made available to employees at a fairly low cost. But yeah, he had sick leave. He had, if you had disability, that was available. That sort of insurance was available. Those were unheard of things. He was making strides in human resources area that weren't even invented yet.
So he formed the air brake company 4 years after the Civil War ended, 1869.
Right, and he was a veteran of the Civil War. He tried to enlist when he was underage, but he eventually, his parents allowed him to go. Luckily for us, he came back because the first thing he did, well, he did get through almost a year of college before dropping out. So I think he had that in common with Frank Conrad. He understood that sometimes a creative mind doesn't fit into a structured school environment.
Formal education.
Yeah.
Right, right.
So he was probably busy making sketches of his air brake idea and soon to follow a switch and signal, so how you move trains around. But the demonstration of having that first air brake, if you've heard the story, was that they were going to set up a test to show that you could stop trains on a dime with the new air brake. The horse and carriage and the whole thing got broke down right in front of the tracks unexpectedly. They did not happen the way they were planning on it. And sure enough, here came the train and it stopped on a dime. And so right then, everyone started embracing the idea. It didn't take long to say, wait a minute, I think this works. And the old way of stopping a train was outrageous. I mean, people were on each car trying to stop it, and it was just archaic and didn't work and very, very dangerous.
So then 2 decades later, he comes up with this electric company.
Well, that all started with he was already working on the alternating current theory and thinking that it was going to be the better way to go. And then there came the big exposition of Chicago of 1893, and Westinghouse won the contract to electrify that big exposition. He won it away from Edison, who was very much competing for it. And meanwhile, so
that was Westinghouse versus GE, basically, right?
Yes, yeah. Exactly. But now here comes other people that are attending this fabulous event. One of them was the man who was trying to harness the energy of Niagara Falls. And so he needed these great big turbines to be built. But he had, previous to the Chicago Exposition, was saying, let's stay away from alternating current. That looks too dangerous, because Edison was on a full-blown anti-AC mode.
Absolutely.
And yeah, including, I think I heard you say earlier,
electrocuting an elephant. Yes, yeah. I remember the story. Yeah.
And he also created the electric chair because he was trying to prove how dangerous alternating current was. Meanwhile, that's how Westinghouse won those contracts. And those turbines that are up there at Niagara Falls that are still generating power today, that's a Westinghouse innovation. And it's most likely what led to the building of this huge plant on 40 acres.
Right.
And 2 million square feet in the building that we're now sitting in. And it was atop one of the other buildings, Building K, that the shack that Frank Conrad ultimately was asked to build in a 1 month period of time from when his Horns article was in the newspaper to his boss calling him into his office the next day saying, I'm going to shut down your little amateur radio station, because he had the vision to turn it into a business, and it became an incredible new business for the company.
Well, talk a little bit about Frank Conrad.
Okay.
This was a very unusual guy with a wonder. I mean, it was basically his hobby became an industry. Am I not mistaken?
Well, absolutely. He was already quite an avid ham operator, and most of the communication was being done by Morse code. Now, Frank wasn't too keen on Morse code. I don't know if he wasn't very good at it, or maybe his fingers were getting a little stiff, out there in the cold mm-hmm. garage when he was working. So he actually ended up creating his own microphone and started trying to do some talking. And then once in a while, he would throw in a song. Well, he was getting feedback from his listeners that, hey, talk less, play more music. And so he ran out of playing his own records, and his wife didn't want him spending too much more money. And that's when he set up this relationship with the Hamilton Music Shop in Wilkinsburg, just up the street, and agreed to mention their name. What the music store found ultimately was that the records that Frank was playing were selling faster. So they saw a direct correlation to helping out Frank with his music collection, and so it was truly his innovation that sort of led to the way that we see commercial radio now.
Yeah, so not only did he invent the idea of radio, terrestrial radio as we've come to know it, but the whole idea of commercial radio as well.
He also coined the phrase broadcasting.
Which was a farm expression.
A farm expression, and he saw it as a way that he could get out a little farther reach.
Yes. They would, the farmers would broadcast the seed.
As I demonstrate broadcasting.
Yes. And that was the idea, was they broadcast a seed, and now he was broadcasting ideas and voice and music to people.
And as a former DJ, and I did play music because they were still playing it on KDKA when I started there in 1989.
I remember well.
But I do believe that Frank Conrad should be called the first radio DJ because he was doing it. Even though it wasn't technically KDKA yet, it was still his little 8XK studio that he had above his garage.
So if I recall, and I should have done a little research, but I think it was the vacuum tube that came about, which allowed you to do music and voice versus just dots and dashes.
Yeah, I believe that was DeForest, I believe. I'm trying to remember. I had that in broadcasting school at Michigan State.
Way back
there.
But there
were a series of inventions. I mean, obviously, the whole ability to do Morse code. And the belief was that, so radio was kind of around and that radio transmissions were around. And it was more seen as something to be used by the military as direct communications with one-on-one communication and also ship-to-shore type of communications. And it was really, I think, Frank's boss, Harry Davis, who had the vision that, wait a minute, we can sell lots of radios. We can garner more listeners.
I was going to ask you about him because Harry Davis, I mean, people do know the name Westinghouse. Frank Conrad is getting, they've even done a play about him now.
Right.
But Harry Davis kind of lost to history, sort of.
Well, you know, I see it as though Frank, because he had this wonderful Westinghouse environment which encouraged creativity, they gave opportunity to dropouts from school, and he recognized some element in Frank Conrad. And so did Harry Davis, I believe. And when Harry Davis and Frank both worked throughout World War I on all those contracts that had to do with creating transmitters and receivers. And so after the war, when he can get back into his ham operation, that was kind of, I think, entertaining to Harry Davis that Frank was doing so well. But it wasn't until he saw that advertisement in Horns, and prior to the Horns advertisement saying, hey, buy a radio here so you can listen to Frank Conrad's broadcast. Well, he was already developing a little bit of
some media coverage.
A lot of it was word of mouth, though. But when Harry had the vision to see what radio could become, and even though Frank invented the first commercial, really, the way they sought to monetize radio in the early days, from like about 1920 to 24, was we'll make our money by selling radios that we build and sell. And of course, after a while, everybody's got a radio, and if it's made by Westinghouse, it probably wasn't going to break, you know, and then they lasted a long time. So that's when they started thinking more about maybe we should do the commercials and find a sponsor for this particular hour of our broadcast and that sort of thing.
If you stop and think about it, there were so many Westinghouse factories, the first thought process was, we've got this thing called radio, if we use that to communicate with our other factories, we don't have to pay for a telegraph.
That's right. And you know, this whole valley was massively filled with employees. We had, I think, around 20,000 employees just in this valley, if you count the 3,000 that were at WABCO up the river, and just up the road, I should say, and about 9, 10, 11, 12,000, and it kept growing, of course, incrementally. They probably hit a few down years during the Depression years, but then it built back up in the 40s, and ultimately, almost everyone you would talk to from Pittsburgh knew someone or was related to someone or maybe several someones who worked for Westinghouse.
Oh, yeah, we all did. I was interested in how in the world did Leo Rosenberg become the first person to do the broadcast?
That's a great question. Actually, so Frank, I think it was decided, we'd better have you standing by at the the garage broadcast station just in case something goes wrong, because this shack was hastily put together. The all of the equipment was just thrown together in 1 month time.
So just like tonight.
Yeah, exactly. So even Frank wasn't completely certain it was going to work. They had high hopes. But leading up to it, they solicited a few employees to say, here, read this. Let me hear how your voice sounds. And Leo Rosenberg was a 24-year-old who was working in the publicity department of Westinghouse. And he was the guy they selected. He got the long straw. So
wow. I heard he didn't like it that much.
Well, he didn't continue. He enjoyed being part of it, but I don't think he saw himself continuing in the broadcast scene. But he was one of the people doing the first church broadcast. He was still the announcer. Well,
talk
then.
About some of the other firsts.
The
baseball, church yeah. broadcast.
Well, the first church broadcast, I read that Leo described wearing the choir robes so that he would fit in with the other person that he from Westinghouse that was there with him while they were, you know, getting the broadcast back. And they would sometimes sing the songs along with the rest of the choir when they were doing that. So that's the first, and then the first baseball game. This was, of course, the next summer, but they went ahead and would drop, like somebody would sit in the top row of the Forbes field and someone else down below was waiting for the scribbled notes on what had happened that inning, would drop it over the side. They'd run over to the telephone and call back in to KDKA.
I don't know if you had a chance to see the documentary with us earlier this evening by Duquesne University. It talked about the fact that their women played an unusually prominent role early on in radio, but it wasn't always that way.
No, not really.
You probably had some difficulties even as late as you came into broadcasting, I would imagine.
Yeah, I was in college in the early 70s, and I started hanging around our college station and really fell in love with it at first sight. I didn't realize all of what was happening behind the scenes, the drama and the excitement of radio. So I started becoming a producer, an engineer, whatever odd job I could pick up. When one of the announcing jobs opened up, I immediately threw my hat in the ring and was told by the program director, who was also a student, that, oh, Suze, we love you, but only guys can be DJs. And this was about 1972. And I kind of hung in there, kept kind of pushing for it, said, you know, and talked to some people further up the food chain and finally, eventually
broke through,
got my break.
We're
but
glad
even
you
coming
did.
Coming out of college, that was still sort of seen as like, oh, okay, I don't know, you know, women DJs. And so, but eventually, you know, it started to move a little bit, where you'd have one female in the overnight role or one female middays and maybe one on the weekends. And I think there's probably still some strides to be made to reach a little more equity.
Well, listen, we're glad that you stuck in there, that you made it. It is wonderful to be with you again and to hear that we wouldn't have had that wonderful voice had you not stuck to it. And thank you again and the people at Westinghouse Shore for making this happen, and I assure you folks, it would not have happened without them stepping in and helping.
So. It is our great pleasure, and great to see you too.
Thank you, Susie. Well, we're giving people credit for all the things that they've done to make this possible, and I think that there's not enough credit to go around for this next guy who really has put his heart and soul into this for decades. And that is Rick Harris. Rick, it's good to have you with us. He's with the National Broadcasting Museum, which is not really a museum yet. We're hoping to make it one. If you were with us earlier, we had Senator Jay Costa with us, who's gotten some grant money that has to be met. But the whole idea here, Rick, am I wrong in saying it, is to actually have a physical museum so that we can let future generations know that right here, this location in Pittsburgh, radio broadcasting commercially began.
There's many more things beyond just Frank Conrad and started KDKA, which we're celebrating 100 years tonight, but it goes all the way back to the 1890s to Reginald Fessenden, who was the electrical engineer.
He was a Canadian, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he was at, it was still called Western University of Pennsylvania, and then later became Pitt. But he, in the 1890s, was experimenting with voice radio here in Pittsburgh at the same time Marconi was experimenting with essentially a Morse code system over in Europe.
So the whole idea of first preserving the Frank Conrad garage where he began doing the broadcast. Talk about that effort, because you were able to save it. Talk about what was going to happen. The garage was going to be dismantled, and you were able to work with a group of people to save that building. Can you talk about that a bit?
Yeah, well, I got involved back in the mid 80s with the Wilkinsburg Centennial. And I met at that time, actually I met some years before that, but Alice Sapienza Donnelly, who was the coordinator of the Centennial, and she, as it turned out, and I think Bill Hillgrove will expand on this, she had saved Conrad's garage from demolition years earlier. And out of the Centennial kind of grew the idea, well, we have to make sure this garage gets preserved in some fashion. And it was on a commercial stretch on Penn Avenue in Wilkinsburg, and essentially all the other homes that were once surrounding it were gone to commercial development. So we worked during the Centennial to make sure that once the Centennial was over, there would be some lasting organization that could work on that effort. And then ultimately, we changed our name to National Museum of Broadcasting, and have had on the table the idea of the Conrad Garage being restored and being the centerpiece of a larger museum.
Let's take a step back, though. Frank Conrad, what he really had done was work with the military, if I recall. The military had said to all the amateur radio operators, you have to cease and desist. We're in what they called the Great War. We now call it World War I.
Right.
But I understand during that time that actually Frank Conrad had the opportunity to work with the U.S. military. It may have given him a leg up on some technologies.
Right, because all the electrical manufacturers were working as contractors for the military, and they kind of suspended the patents that each one of them owned so they could make things that another company owned the patents for. And Westinghouse was one of the great suppliers of radio equipment, and it was that all development was headed by Frank Conrad from his garage, essentially. It was where he designed a lot of the first airplane radio equipment, the air to ground, which was so important in the war effort there, because you could get an airplane up in the air really for the first time in a conflict, but you needed to get that information back to the ground. And he developed power generation systems so that could power the radio equipment and get that directly from the pilots down to the ground.
So we had just gone through a pandemic, something we know a little bit about these days. Vast numbers of people had died. We had the Great War. Vast numbers of people had died. And there was an election, which they were going to broadcast about, and the perception of that election was a return to normalcy. Mm-hmm. So as we approached the election in 1920, that what they were doing really was taking a defense technology mm-hmm. and using it for domestic purposes.
Right. Right. And what essentially happened at the end of the war was patents, restrictions went back into play here, and Westinghouse found itself kind of sitting on the outside because it didn't own a lot of transmitting patents, but they were able to get a lot of receiver patents, and they didn't know what they would use them for, but then you had, in October of 1919, Radio Corporation of America, RCA, was formed. With General Electric, their Westinghouse's arch rival, being the lead organization on that. And so Westinghouse sort of found itself on the outside looking in until Conrad kind of flipped the whole idea. Instead of radios being a point-to-point thing or private communications between stations, opening it up to everybody. And now when Harry Davis kind of saw this ad in the Horns department store in September of 1920, a light bulb went off in his head that here, we've got these patents for receivers, we could make them because we have the license, and we could set up our own station like this, much larger than Conrad's, much more powerful, and use that as a business opportunity and use our idle World War I manufacturing facilities to produce these simple radios. And on our table behind you, we have a number of crystal radio sets, including the first one that Westinghouse made for sale to the public.
So when these radios, let's go back to the ad at Joseph Horn Company, when they advertised receivers for $10, In 1920, $10 was a lot of money. It doesn't right. sound like much, but that right. was a lot of money back then.
Right. That's why you found many, many people building their own, taking an oatmeal box, an empty oatmeal box, and winding coils of wire around it, and then getting a crystal, galena crystal, and a pair of headphones was about the most expensive thing you had, and with a few simple things and a 100-foot-long antenna into your backyard, you could pick up the amateurs who were doing things like Conrad and then ultimately KDKA. And the great thing about it is these crystal sets that are 100 years old, they still work, they can still pick up stations on the AM band today. And it's hard to believe that there's any other technology that goes back that far that you can still use the equipment from 100 years ago and still get the content.
What an incredible story. We've spent hours this evening learning about it with the Duquesne University documentary, which was so well done, and talking to a variety of people. How in the world, Rick, do we get this National Broadcast Museum constructed? What is the road forward for the National Museum of Broadcasting?
It's an uncertain road right now. I mean, as you know, we've worked for many, many years on trying this. And the efforts go back to at least the 1940s. Late Congressman John McDowell at that time, who was from Wilkinsburg and a friend of Conrad, back in the 1940s, when the Wilkinsburg Elks purchased Conrad's former home there on Penn Avenue, and were going to put up a marker and some commemoration, he said back then, 75 years ago, it was about time that this happened, and here we are, the 100th anniversary, and we still don't have anything. I think it's going to take a lot of support from elected officials, from the foundations, from the corporations, and Pittsburghers who have gone on beyond here, say in radio, television, and the media, to really want to help out their hometown, which is really the city more so than any other in the world where radio, television, and electronic technology that we enjoy today has come from. And we really have to I think, use this event as a springboard to make that happen.
Well, hopefully it can happen. I mean, we've talked about this before. I don't want this, people to think this is nothing we haven't given thought to, but we talked about the fact that, you know, there's no reason that the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame is in Cleveland. Mm-hmm. But the reality is, if you stop and think about a museum of broadcasting, it's more than rock and roll. It's every kind of music that's ever played over the radio. People would never have heard it without the invention that we're talking about 100 years ago today. Every news event, movies, every bit of mm-hmm. entertainment. If you are watching a television program, you're watching dramas, if you're watching westerns, if you're watching comedies, all of those shows were first done on radio. And so all of that, all of the history of all of that entertainment, all of that information, man landing on the moon, coverage of man in wars, every big story, it all came down to radio. So if it didn't happen here, we wouldn't be able to say this is where this museum belongs.
Right.
And it is where it belongs. But the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, you've talked to me about this before, it cost a lot of money to build, but they made it back the first year mm-hmm. because there was a demand of people to be able to see and to know all of these things.
Right. And as you've pointed out, if you're not into rock and roll, that's maybe not some place you go to, and it's focused very narrowly compared to broadcasting, which is
everything in our lives.
Right.
Everything. Yeah.
Everything for the last 100 years it's had an impact on.
We've laughed among ourselves because we'll be talking to our dear friend Bill Hillgrove very shortly, who's the voice of the Panthers and the Steelers, and Bill knows the story very well. The first professional football team was from Latrobe, Pennsylvania. Mm-hmm. Latrobe was offered the museum, which is the Pro Football Hall of Fame. They said, we don't want it. Let Canton, Ohio have it. Guess what?
Yeah.
It's the identity of Canton, and it's created so much wealth and so much commerce for that. So we could see that there's a lot of benefits to actually having a museum here that can commemorate the event that we're talking about today and all the things that have sprung from it.
Right, and I think it would be one of the premier educational and tourism generating institutions in Pittsburgh if we were to do this. It could be for Pittsburgh what the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame has been for Cleveland. I just am still mystified that we've been working on this for so many years that we just haven't made it clear enough to people that if you build it, they will come, and that's what we need to do.
So you have a website. If people can visit the website, and if they want to, become part of this. Is there a way for them to do that?
Yeah, if people out there would want to contribute to this, we have a donate now button on the website. We hope to have maybe some crowdfunding as we go forward on this, and we've got now some wonderful partners with Duquesne University and the RIDC and Westinghouse Shore, and I hope that list of interested groups continues to grow. But we do have in the state capital budget, I think you touched on it, $1.5 million that can get this museum started if we can come up with non-state matching funds.
So every dollar up to $1.5 million that people donate will be matched one for one with state money. It'll help us leverage that money.
Exactly, and we could use it to ultimately get the Conrad Garage rebuilt and do other recreations and things like we have with the KDKA shack here and really make this a true draw for Pittsburgh.
I have to tell a story though, by the way. So this is obviously not the original studio. This is a mock-up that has been used previously, but in that mock-up was a transmitter which ended up at the Westinghouse Museum and then ended up at the Smithsonian National, the Heinz History Museum. Mm-hmm. And we thought, well, you know, it's the 100th anniversary. If there's ever a reason to drive that thing from the Strip District here and let us borrow it so that we can commemorate the 100th anniversary, it couldn't happen. There's no way. Your federal government at work, even our dear friend Congressman Doyle, who I will mention again, is the chairman of the committee that controls all of broadcasting. His office tried as hard as they could, but you can't get through the bureaucracy that is the federal government. So, Rick, you did yeoman duty and reconstructed in the last weeks this transmitter, which it looks fabulous. I don't know how you do that, but for everything else that you've done, that's an incredible bit of work, too, that you deserve to have credited to. I know that there were a lot of sleepless nights getting this done.
Yeah, well, it's not quite finished even tonight, but it was the best we can do, and I kind of think that 100 years ago tonight, they were putting the finishing touches on that thing as it went on the air, so we're kind of in the same boat as Frank Conrad, and his assistant, Donald Little, were the guys that did it, and they were, as you said, so worried about the testing of it in the couple of nights before that they sent Conrad back to his station to ready to take over as a backup. But there's one very interesting thing in here that I do want to point out for those who are interested in the technical aspects. The phonograph, and if there are wonderful pictures online if you search for them of the both the four men in the shack, but also a close-up of the transmitting equipment, including the phonograph. And a friend of mine, James O'Neill, who's a writer for Radio World, among other publications, just came out with a great article about the technical aspects of this first broadcast. And we had been talking months ago about it, and I noted to him, take a look at this photo real closely of the phonograph, and you'll see there's no reproducer on the phonograph acoustically, and that's how these phonographs work, of course. I said, there's an electrical connection from the phonograph right into the transmitter.
My goodness.
And so what he determined and what we kind of discussed was literally about 5 years before electrical recordings became kind of standard in the recording industry, Conrad and Donald Little had put together an electrical pickup for that broadcast. And what it meant was the not having to go through acoustically through the phonograph and into the microphone and get distortion and poor quality, they would have had a very good signal for the phonograph records they produced.
Feeding it straight into the transmitter.
Right. And then plus with a switch on there between the mic and the phonograph, when they were playing the phonograph records, then they could talk among themselves without being heard over the air. So we think that this, not only was it innovative in its whole idea of a broadcast, but it was innovative in the technology that they were using. They were years ahead of their time.
Rick, how much equipment, how much programming, how much of the artifacts of the origin of broadcasting would be available for such a museum as the one that you're thinking about?
Well, I mean, we actually have no artifacts of, say, the KDKA shack. It was torn down back in the 1930s, and Conrad's garage, everything that was in there was gone over the years. There may be a few pieces around, but a lot of them were Westinghouse made pieces of equipment, so you can still find them. The radio receiver sitting on the back bench there was a prototype in 1920 for that broadcast, but then it was designed by Conrad and they manufactured them in the following years. So you can still find pieces and do replications, and that's kind of what we're trying to do.
But as radio evolved from that first broadcast 100 years ago tonight to today, there are artifacts from the different types of equipment that were used, the different types of receivers. Some of the original programming, I imagine, has been saved. Mm-hmm. It's been recorded, it's transcribed other places.
Yeah, there are lots of collections of transcription discs that go back to at least the 1930s, and even that recreation we heard in the video tonight would have been on a transcription disc and sent to different stations and outlets to send out over the air. So there's a lot of recording material, and as you well know, a whole 80 plus years of recorded radio programs that are available, many of them online. It's just, and that's kind of how I got into this. My parents grew up in the golden age of radio, and when I was a kid, they were telling me about all the shows that used to be on radio. And when I was growing up, it was mostly music and sports and things like that. There wasn't these dramas and comedies and things. Those were all on television, but not on radio. And I was just fascinated by some of the names of the shows. And then I wanted to listen to them. So you could go to Carnegie Library and get records out and listen to them. And eventually I wanted to have an old radio that I could figure out how to play the shows through the radio speaker. And that kind of got me into the technology side of things. So,
well, when I go for walks now, or I'm outside working doing yard work, I have my iPhone, and I'm listening to podcasts of old radio shows from back in the 30s, 40s, old detective shows, old westerns, comedies, whatever you want. So those the new technology that was begotten through radio now helping people relive the radio broadcast that got us there. So, Rick, thank you very much for everything that you've done, for carrying this forward. Any closing thoughts that you'd have?
Well, I want to thank, there are a tremendous amount of people who worked on this effort going back 30 more or more years when we got started way back in the 1980s. And sadly, many of them have not live to see this 100th anniversary.
And I'm not feeling too good myself.
but there are so many more people than I could ask, but I would say a great deal of debt is owed to people like Alice Sapiens and Don Lee saving the garage and making, I don't think we would be here at all tonight if it weren't for her. And then people like Bill Beal and Marjorie Michaud, who were both KDKA people, Bill Brandt, just the list goes on and on. Paul Long, I mean, just so many giants in the Pittsburgh broadcasting industry who contributed so much and didn't live to see this and didn't live to see a museum started. And hopefully in their memory, we're going to get this done and it'll be permanent. And I think that's what has to happen.
Well, from your lips to Frank Conrad's ears, somewhere up in heaven. Thanks a lot, Rick.
Thanks.
My sweetie, ain't you, baby? Sure, indeedy, ain't you, baby? If you crave me, come and show it. Don't be bashful, make me know it. Like my kissing, don't you, baby? Oh, now listen, won't you, baby? Speak your mind without restraint. Is you is or is you ain't? Positively and no maybe, baby, ain't you mine?
This is old home week now. I get to talk to one of my dear friends, Bill Hillgrove. Bill, how are you?
I'm great, Ron.
I know you are, but other than that, how are you?
This has been a great evening.
Yeah, that's good.
I've learned so much.
I have too.
And
Listen, how did you get involved in this? Because you've really been a stalwart. I think every time I talk to Rick Harris, you're there, and you're the president of this museum group.
I got involved through my mother-in-law, Alice Sapiens and Donnelly.
The godmother of the whole movement.
And she was the one in 1972 who threatened to stand in front of the bulldozer in case they wanted to take the Conrad garage down, which never happened. It was taken down brick by brick and stored on pallets. And hopefully, because of her and a lot of folks, Rick Harris and all the other people who have had anything to do with this, someday it becomes a reality. Right now it's on the drawing board. Someday, hopefully in my lifetime, that, you know, it becomes a reality and is part of the Pittsburgh culture.
What motivated Alice Sapienza Donnelly?
That's a good question. She had a great sense of history. And she was born and raised in Homewood, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And she remembers her father taking her to the Cathedral of Learning and saying, "See that brick right up there? That's your brick." You know, she just had that sense of the community, of what Pittsburgh is all about. And certainly the point has been made here many times tonight that the Pittsburgh area should have the National Museum of Broadcasting. It shouldn't be anywhere else.
Yeah.
She was born in August of 1920. So she kind of parallels.
She was alive.
She was alive
when the broadcast took place.
Harding and Cox.
She didn't vote yet. It.
No, I don't know that she voted, but she voted early and often.
Yeah.
She, you know, just think about it, Ron. All of the changes that she was able to witness in those almost 100 years. She passed away in 2019, and she even said, "I want Zambelli fireworks for my 100th birthday." Well, she made it to 99, and I can tell you this, that this past August, we were at my place at Conneaut Lake, and just out of the blue, a theater friend of my daughter's said, "I have some fireworks in the trunk." And sure enough, for Alice Sapienza Donnelly, we celebrated her 100th birthday. She wouldn't be around to see this become a reality. As Rick Harris said, a lot of people won't, but I hope I am, and I just hope it happens soon.
Yeah. What has been the biggest obstacle is this? I mean, because it on one level, Bill, this seems like a no-brainer. But on the other hand, I mean, getting people, everybody says, "Well, it's a great idea, it's a wonderful idea," but it doesn't get over that speed bump.
We need people to get involved. You've become involved. We need more veteran broadcasters to become involved with our board so that we can get some energy, some new energy, mm-hmm. to get this thing really propelled. And also, certainly, the financial help. I remember when Rick and the organization were completely out of money. Well, how are we going to pay for the storage of the Conrad garage? And I said, "Well, you know, there's a guy who's involved in broadcasting who's a Pittsburgher. Went to the University of Pittsburgh from Mount Lebanon. His name is Mark Cuban. And I interviewed him once at the halftime of a Pitt basketball game that he happened to attend. And I said, I have his email address. I'll approach him." And I sent him a note, said, "We need your financial help." And KDKA, I mentioned that. And of course, he said he grew up with KDKA. And, you know, he, as the guy who really, what was it, broadcast.com that he sold to really make his original fortune. We sent him a note requesting his help. And all he sent back was, "Are you 501c3? And we said, "Yes, we are." And 2 weeks later, Rick Harris got a big check in the mail that helped us continue the storage of the Conrad garage.
Got over that.
We need more people like the Mark Cubans of the world, but we also need everybody's support. Mm-hmm. Anybody who cares at all about Pittsburgh, about its history relative to broadcasting, we need your help. And so, you know, let's just hope that this idea becomes a reality.
Well, this is a great kickoff. I mean, the fact we've been talking about this this 100th anniversary for seems like 100 years, but not quite. But we've been talking about it for a while. Of course, there were all kind of plans, but then came the pandemic, and so the COVID-19 has kind of knocked us. But you know, it was wonderful that you know, RIDC stepped forward, Duquesne University stepped forward, the folks at Westinghouse, sure, and others. Maybe this is the impetus now to get this, to, you know, momentum is a wonderful thing when you got it, right?
We need an avalanche.
Yeah, we do.
They start small.
Yeah. Well, and grow. Let me go a different direction, Bill, because I'm sure everybody would be interested. Somewhere back the line, this whole invention of radio had to have a big impact on Bill Hillgrove, because you made it your life's work. You know, nobody paints a picture of a sporting event, I think, in my lifetime, like you do. You just have a tremendous talent and you use it so well. What inspired you to become that marvelous voice?
It happened at a young age. I was 13 years of age. My aunt, Sister Mary Bernard, was a sister of charity, and she had a friend in the charity order who had the Pittsburgh Diocesan Radio TV School. Her name was Sister Rosalie. And since my dad was an electrician, I figured, well, maybe I can go to this radio TV school and learn how to fix radios and TVs.
Fix them.
And so I show up at the behest of my aunt, and the nun said, here's the script, I want you to read it. I'm like, what? So I read the script, and she said, that's exactly what I want. I said, what's that, sister? She said, a 13-year-old brat. I said, I don't need a script for that. You know, I come by that naturally, and I found out at a very young age that I had the ability to be on this side of the microphone.
Sure.
And as a matter of fact, WDUQ was my first place where I actually got to be this 13-year-old brat on live radio drama.
Oh, boy.
And we were on a couple of McKee sports stations as well. And you know, I always loved sports. From my home in Garfield up on top of the hill, I could see the light standards at Forbes Field. And I often said as a kid, boy, I'd like to be a part of that someday. Well, I didn't become a part of the Pirates, but I became part of the Pittsburgh sports scene, and I was able to take this passion for sports and meld it with my love of being on this side of the microphone, and it's worked out pretty well.
Well, I think there's so many of us. I mean, I remember distinctly, I was only about 2 or 3 years old, and I remember just mesmerized by both the radio and the television. At that point in time, as a you know, 2 or 3 year old, I actually thought the small people were in that little box, you know. But of course, you grow up and you learn that. But you know, I think so many of us just fell in love with the spoken word, the description, the music, the acting, the whatever it happened to be, and it changes lives. It'd be horrible for that to be lost and for future generations not to understand how this all came about.
It is the art of communication, and with radio, it became a bigger art. To take somebody's idea from their brain and put it into somebody else's brain, that's communication.
Yeah.
But with the miracle that Frank Conrad helped us to achieve, we were able to do it mass, broadcast, the farm term. And it's just such a wonderful thing. And as you have pointed out, and we have heard so many times this evening, you know, that this art form, this communication process is so important. That cell phone that you have in your pocket, It wouldn't be in existence if it weren't for Frank Conrad.
Right. Yeah. Well, you know, we haven't, to my knowledge, used the expression, but I've always loved the expression that radio is the theater of the mind.
Yes.
You can, when you do it, with every sportscast that you do, every broadcast that you do, people in their mind are watching that football or basketball game that you are describing. And you have a way of carrying them through that. And so they're going to sit there for however many hours, and they're going to listen. Their love of sports and the theater of the mind, you create in their mind's eye the event as if they were sitting there watching it.
Ron, you've done radio, you've done television. To me, there's no comparison.
No.
The freedom of radio. When I get behind that microphone, I can describe anything that I choose to. I can be influenced by what I'm watching. Unfortunately, television, there are so many restrictions,
yeah,
including somebody talking in your ear as you try to talk. Radio, you don't have that. You've got that freedom to describe. And it's just a wonderful, satisfying thing to be part of.
Well, somebody described it, well, here's where I lose the room entirely, except you and I. But somebody was talking about Fibber McGee and Molly. Every time Fibber McGee would open the closet door, you heard all, and the sounds would vary, you know, week to week. On TV, he could do it one time. Once they saw it,
That was it.
It wasn't funny the second time. But on radio, it went on year after year after year, and every week people laughed at the same thing because it was the mind's eye. You could, by changing, you know, Spike Jones. There's no more Spike, but that was using sound effects, making, you know, none of this would have happened without Frank Conrad and the invention of radio. And that story needs to be told, and that National Broadcasting Museum needs to be built in Pittsburgh.
No question.
It does.
And let's build it soon.
All right. Bill Hillgrove, legend, broadcaster, my friend, good to be with you.
Kid from Garfield.
That's it, kid from Garfield. And not Garfield the cat either. Thanks for being with us, Billy.
You're welcome, Ron. Right. Always a pleasure.
Nobody else but you. You caught my eye, and I've got a feeling I'm falling. Show me the ring and I'll jump right through. I used to travel single, oh, we chance to make.
Well, this has been a remarkable night. It occurred to me if we go any longer, it will no longer be November 2nd, so we have to wrap up. But I want to thank first Ron Klink, an extraordinary moderator. Ron,
thank you, my friend.
It's been a real pleasure, and you really have just been a tireless supporter of this important piece of Pittsburgh history, and we look forward to continuing to partner in our work.
I do as well. You're wonderful to work with, Ken. Thank you. And Duquesne University.
Also, our other partners at the National Museum of Broadcasting, but particularly Rick Harris. It's been stated a little bit, but he has truly worked tirelessly to preserve and protect this piece of history, has been working on it for decades. So we greatly appreciate that, Rick, and all that you've given to this enterprise. Also, Susie Barber and our partners at Westinghouse Shore, and Dawn Smith, Ellie Ezel and her team, and the partners at RIDC. I also want to thank Dawn Ma. Dawn, could you take your headphones off and come over here for a second? Dawn is the producer extraordinaire from Duquesne University. He serves as the director for the Duquesne University Center for Emerging and Innovative Media. Has really been the mastermind. You can't see
you
it.
Take
here,
your mask off, they can see what you look like.
Yeah, there's literally a television studio set up here in the RIDC facility in order to make this possible. So, Dawn, we appreciate all of your extraordinary.
It was magical.
It was magical.
It really was
just
magical.
Just like the first production. And we also want to thank Joey DC over there, Duquesne alum and co-producer of the live event. So it was about 50 degrees in here, but we didn't feel the cold really. These guys have been just working incredibly since the moment we started. And in some ways it reminded me as a kid who, you know, went to Paul Shannon's Adventure Time and some of those shows, that this is kind of like the original TV and radio where you just let it happen.
That's it.
And it has been marvelous and magical. Tomorrow I'll be here starting at 7 o'clock with some special guests. 7 o'clock, Larry Richard from KDKA, and 8 o'clock, actor David Conrad, who, as we mentioned, is the great-grandson of Frank Conrad. Then at 8:30, we'll have a Zoom video interview with Jack Bogut, the iconic figure from KDKA and the inventor of Farkleberry tarts. Then at 9 o'clock, Jim Robinault, an expert on the Harding-Cox election and an expert on presidential history from that era. At 9:30, Joseph Sabino, mystic, and former Governor Tom Corbett, who will actually be doing duty for KDKA covering the election, will zoom into our show. And 10 o'clock, Susie Barber will join me to talk about the election returns. And throughout the evening, we will also have periodic reports from the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette giving us updates on the election, just as 100 years ago, the Pittsburgh Post provided that information. So please join us tomorrow for some coverage of the 2020 election, as we also talk about parallels with the 1920 election. And with that, I just want to again thank our co-moderator here, Ron Klink, and we will sign off.
By. When two lovers woo, they still say, I love you, on that you can rely. No matter what the future brings, as time goes by. Moonlight and love songs, never out of date, hearts full of passion, jealousy and hate. Woman needs man, and man must have his mate, that no one can deny. It's still the same old story, a fight for love and glory, a case of do or die. And the world will always welcome
heaven on earth, stay out of the south.